Well, good morning, everyone. God bless you all. It's so good to see you today. So good to be here in the presence of the Lord. Amen, amen, amen. Glory to your name. Glory, 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 glory. Amen. I want to just, just give God the glory for what he's doing. Because I know that there's something that's happening in the spiritual realm that is really has gotten God's attention. Amen. And I hope that it also get your attention. Because what God is doing right now is bringing us into remembrance of who we are. Amen. Let's pray. Father, we come to you now in the gracious and mighty name of Jesus. Father, we thank you for this time together. We thank you, Father, for your word that will go forth in this place. We thank you, Father, for your Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, we welcome you into this place. We look to you with confidence, with boldness, with accuracy. We know that you will not lead us into error, but we know you'll lead us and guide us into all truth, and you'll show us things to come. Father, I ask in the name of Jesus that you reveal to our hearts the things that you would have us to know and to understand for this hour. Lord, we are in a place, Father, where if you don't show up, nothing is going to happen that's going to be good on behalf of the people. Because we know that all good gifts and all perfect gifts come from above. And so, Father, we ask in the name of Jesus that you would breathe upon us, and let your grace and mercy be extended toward us once again. Let the body of Christ come to acknowledge you, and let them begin to cry out to you on behalf of our land and the people of the land. Father, I'm reminded right now of some things that I will talk about a little bit, because you just bring them to my heart and to my thoughts. And so, Father, I ask you that you will anoint every ear to hear, prepare every heart to receive, make my tongue as of a pen of a red writer, to write your word upon the hearts, upon the mind of your people, that they will know the truth, and that the truth shall make them free. And, Father, we covenant with you now to give you the glory, the honor, and praise in Jesus' mighty name. Amen and amen. Well, glory to God. Can you put a song on that for me, please?
Sure.
Amen. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. What is it?
I need to be still.
Okay, it'll be fine. That's right. You need to be still. Glory to God. Thank you, Father. We worship you. We worship you, Father. I need to be still and let God love me. I need to be still and let God love me. When this old world about to push and shove me, I need to be still. Let God love me. I need to relax and let God take over. I need to relax and let God take over. He'll take this load off of my shoulder. I need to relax and let God take over. When trouble's all around me, when my soul cries out for rest,
When I feel that I'm failing, and even though I've done my best, when decisions get so heavy, and there's answers that I need, I know it's time to just be still and let God love me. I need to be still and let God love me. I need to be still and let God love me. When this old world tried to push and shove me, I need to be still and let God love me. I need to be still and let God love me. I need to be still and let God love me. When this old world tried to push and shove me, I need to be still and let God love me. Jesus. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
Need to be still and let God love me. Amen. We are in a good place today. We are in the house of God.
Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Amen. Amen, amen. Well, we're dealing with a message today that I believe with all my heart that God has put this in. He gave me this message, and I've been preaching for a while, but you know what? I tried to get off of this message, and God said no. God said no. And then now I see that we see that a lot is happening in the world, and mainly, what I'm sensing that what's happening in the world, it has everything to do with people have turned their back on God. Sin. Amen. And God is not going to, he's not going to wink his eye at this sin that he's observing, that he's seeing in our nation and in our land. And one of the main things is that it's been enforced by those that's in authority in our land. And we are in a place right now where we're seeing disasters hidden in certain regions, in certain places. And from my understanding, these are areas where sin have become so openly, so seeing that it become a stench to the nostrils of God. Amen. And I'm reminded about, you know, when God told Noah to build an ark, how the land and the people of the land was acting, how they was living, and so forth. And God is, and I believe that God is looking at our land, and he's looking at the people, and he's looking at the things that is happening, and I don't think God is pleased with it. Amen. I just feel like God's not pleased with it, because we're about to experience some things in the earth like we have never experienced before, and it all because of sin. It's all because of sin. And I know that people are talking about righteousness, and people are talking about once you are born again, you're born again forever. I know I hear people talking about that. I hear people talking about sin. Jesus Christ died for our sin once and for all. I read that myself, amen. But I also see that sin can also cause you to be separated from God, amen. How does sin separate us from God? When you know to do right and continue to do wrong, it's not something that's going to, my God, it's not something that we can take lightly. Because you see, it becomes more than just sin. It becomes transgression, because you know to do right, but then you choose to do wrong. It becomes a transgression. Amen. Then it becomes iniquity. Amen. It's just something that God is totally against. And we as a people need to see what God is saying to us. Amen. We need to see what God is saying. Because this is not something that we can just take lightly. This is something that I believe that God is saying to us that we need to be aware of. Amen. Is that YouTube on, honey? What's going on back there? Okay. Okay, so I believe it's about to come. It's working, right?
It's
slow.
Maybe just slow. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, it's there.
Okay. Good. Amen. Glory to God. So when we're seeing disasters take place in different areas and different regions. Amen, in the land. And we know that it's the same thing, you know, when sin go openly and just like the people begin to welcome sin. It's the same as Sodom and Gomorrah. Amen. It's the same as Sodom and Gomorrah. God rained down fire upon Sodom and Gomorrah because of their sin. Now, you want to have nude beaches and all this kind of stuff. You want to have all these kind of places where people can look wherever they look, the way they want to look, do what they want to do, and not come under condemnation because of it. Well, you know what? You think just because man is okay with man, because that's the nature of man. Nature is sin. But God's nature is not sin. The nature of God is righteousness and holiness. The nature of God is to God has called us to be separated from sin. And when you don't understand, you say, "Well, Pastor, well, I don't understand why is it so everybody doing it?" Yeah, everybody's doing it. That's the whole problem. Everybody's doing it. Amen. And why are they doing it? Because it's been made a law. It's been put into law. That's why people are doing it. And that's why we see disasters that are taking place in different regions of our land. Because they are practicing sin openly. And it's not just a sin. What God called it? Abomination. God called it abomination. It's not just sin. It is abomination before God. And you think if it was abomination before God back in Sodom and Gomorrah day, you think it's not going to be abomination in this hour of what we're living in today? It's still the same sin. And I believe that God is trying to get our attention. Amen. So he says in Isaiah chapter 59, verse number 1 and 2. Isaiah 59, verse 1 and 2. "And behold, the Lord's hand is not shortened that it cannot save, neither is ear heavy that it cannot hear." God wants to hear you. God wants to hear from his people. He wants to hear from his creation. He wants to hear from them that he created in his image and after his likeness. He wants to see. He wants to hear. He wants to know that you are honoring him, that you're respecting him. Amen. He don't want to see you dishonor him. He don't want to see you disrespect him. He don't want to see you turn away from him to serve flesh.
Yeah. Amen.
That's not what God wants to see. He wants to see you come to him with reverence. He wants to see you come to him with a repentant heart. He wants you to come to him knowing that your sin are forgiven. Amen. But he's not going to get, you think you're going to ask forgiveness, then go back and just keep continuing to do, living that lifestyle, doing what you're doing and thinking that there's no repercussion of it? It's abomination before God. Look what happened in Brazil. They parade the streets with this mess. And look what happened. Did God allow it to continue? No, he didn't, did he? What make you think God's going to allow it here in America? What make you think that you have become so powerful that God can't do nothing with you? God is giving you a warning. And he's telling you to repent and turn from your wicked ways. And he's giving you this warning, and he's giving it to you firm. Because there's something coming upon the land that if you don't repent, you're going to need more than a doctor to save you. God is calling us. He's giving us a fair warning to repent. Verse number 2 said, but your iniquity have separated between you and your God. Your iniquities have separated between you and your God, and your sin have hid his face from you. That he will not see, that he will not hear. And look at verse number 3. For your hands are defiled with blood, and your fingers with iniquity. Your lips have spoken lies, your tongue had muttered perverseness. In other words, your whole body is reacting to the sin that is in you. And God has given us a way out. God has given us a way out. And I know that, because see, I wanted to stop this message. I wanted to stop this message because it ran everybody out of my church. But God said, don't stop. God said, don't stop. And so I have to obey God, whether people come or don't come. I have to obey God. Amen. Because you see, your life is at hand. And I will not get this warning from God to tell you to turn away from your wickedness and not give you the message that God has given you, and the blood, your blood be required to my hand. That's not going to work. And I remember when God first started dealing with my heart about this message, and he was showing me the darkness was coming up on the face of the earth. He showed me a big tidal wave coming, and I said, oh God, what a great move of your spirit. And God said, no, that is not a move of my spirit. He said, this is darkness, and it's coming up on the face of the earth. And he said, warn my people, for the end of all things is at hand. Now, and then later on, I saw God showed me again that the sin, that the danger was coming. I looked and I saw this rider riding his horse in this. I was in the spirit, and I saw this man riding his horse, and he was going in a direction, and it was me, Kendall Hagin, and someone else walked behind us, mad and strangling. And as we was walking across this field, this horseman coming up to the right side, and he was speeding on up, and then all of a sudden he started to gallop, and then he turned over to the left, then he turned to the left again and came right down and parked his horse right beside me, and he handed me a scroll from his side, and he said, take it and read it. And as I opened up that scroll, began to read the scroll, and it said in the name, it said, no, it said, warn my people. And then at the same time, I saw the clouds. It was a beautiful blue sky with puffy little white clouds. Then all of a sudden, I saw the clouds roll back out of the way as I was reading this thing. I saw the clouds roll back out of the way, and I saw God's handwriting in the sky. I saw the handwriting of God in the sky. And he said, warn my people, for the end of all things is at hand. And folks, I'm here to tell you right now that God has given us three warnings. Three warnings. Amen. And just Tuesday, just Friday night, right here in our church, while we come to our prayer night, we're sitting out here praying, and all of a sudden, I'm starting to pray in the Holy Ghost, and then I'm interpreting what I'm hearing God say in the Spirit. And God said, tell my people to prepare themselves and begin to prepare themselves of meditating on the healing scriptures, meditating on the healing messages, because there's coming something upon the land that they will not be able to be cured unless God do it. And you're going to need the word of God in your spirit, because God said he's going to recall those words that you allowed to germinate in your spirit. That's going to cause it to rise up on the inside of you. That's going to bring healing and deliverance to you. Now, if you don't do what God is saying, don't mean that I didn't tell you, because I'm telling you what God said. And I'm not one of those preachers going to tell you that everything is going to be all right. It's going to be a beautiful year. It's going to be a glamorous time. I'm not going to come here telling you no lies. I'm going to tell you what God said. And what God is saying is telling you to repent and turn from your wicked ways. He's talking to America. And he's talking to the church. Now, I hear preachers talking against what I'm talking about, but you know what? It doesn't matter. I'm not going to listen to them. I'm not going to pay attention to what they're saying. I'm going to continue to preach what God tells me to preach. I'm going to continue to hold fast to what God has told me to do. I tried to quit this message. God said, no, it has not touched the heart of man the way I intend for it to touch. And God said, don't stop preaching. Preach that message. And I said, okay, God. I said, Lord, but the people don't want to come and hear this message. He said, preach it. And I know it's hard. Amen. Because let me tell you something. It dealt with my own life. This message dealt with my own life. I know what it does. It's gonna cut you to your heart. It's gonna cause you to begin to examine your heart. It's gonna cause you to look at yourself the way God sees you. Then all God is asking you to do is to repent. That's all God is asking you to repent and turn from your wicked way. If my people, which are called by my name, would humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways. He said, then will I hear from heaven, and I'll forgive their sin, and I will heal the land. And I'm telling you, boy, we are in a place right now that God is trying to get our attention. And if we don't pay attention to what God is saying, we're going to be caught up in this darkness so much to the point that we will not be able to escape. But God has given us an opportunity now. He's warning us. He's given us an opportunity to examine our hearts. Amen. And to turn away from the sin that is working in the land. Hallelujah. So now, how does sin separate us from God? Sin defiles. Sin causes you to be less than what God created you to be. Sin causes you to walk a separate direction than what God has called you to walk. Sin causes you to pay more attention to things that is unclean, unholy. Sin causes you to take pleasure in doing things that God is not pleased with. Sin calls you to turn your back on God. God don't turn his back on you. You turn your back on God. Why? Because you are enjoying sin. You're enjoying what you're doing. You're living a lifestyle that you think that's gonna make you be the person you was created to be. The Bible said in Isaiah chapter 53, verse number 6, he said, all we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned every man, everyone from his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. Amen. We all like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way. See, people are going their own way, not submitting themselves to God's way. And that what he said in Romans 10, 17? Excuse me, Romans 10, verse 1. Brethren, my heart desires prayer for God for Israel, that they might be saved. For a bad record that they have a zeal of God, but not according to knowledge. For they've been ignorant of God's righteousness, going about to establish their own righteousness, not submitting themselves to the righteousness of God. Amen. See, God knows where we are. God knows what he's expecting out of us. God knows what he needs us to do. But we have to understand what we need to do. We have to repent. We have to turn from our wicked ways. The Bible said in 1 John 1, 9, said, if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sin and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But we have to confess our sin. Amen. We have to confess our sin. Amen. To be cleansed from all unrighteousness. Why? Because this is one of the things, this is how sin causes you to be separated from God. If you don't confess your sin, you're going to allow sin to continue to run rampant in your life, then you are not going to walk in the presence of God. You're walking in darkness. You're deceiving yourself. You're self-deceived and don't even realize it. The Bible says in 1 John chapter 3, verse number 4, everyone who makes a practice of sinning also practices lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. See, when you practice sin, you are practicing lawlessness. It's become a part of you. And then you open up the door to witchcraft. You open up the door to satanic worship. You open up the door to spiritual wickedness in high places. Why? Because you have yielded to the will of the enemy instead of the will of God. And so you want God to intervene in your life? You want God to intervene in your life? Then just simply repent. Simply repent. God will do what he said he would do in his word. He will deliver you. He will set you free. He will cause you to see yourself in a way that you will know that you are not alone. Amen. The Bible says in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 9, or do you not know that the unrighteous will not inherit the kingdom of God? Do not be deceived, neither the sexual immorality, or adultery, nor men who practice homosexuality or thieves, nor the greedy or drunkards, amen, or revelers, or I'm telling you, suits and all this stuff. You're practicing wickedness and you think that you're going to inherit the kingdom of God? God said, no. No swindler will inherit the kingdom of God. Amen. You will not inherit the kingdom of God. The Bible said in James chapter 1, verse number 14, but each person is tempted when he is lured and enticed by his own desire. Then desire, when it is conceived, giveth birth to sin, and sin, when it is fully grown, bringeth forth death. Death. Amen. When it is fully grown, bring it forth death. Glory to God. We have to see what God is saying to us, because you see, since God is the creator and giver of life, to be separated from him means to be experiencing death. To be separated from God because of sin, you begin to experience death. See, in the Garden of Eden, when Adam sinned, he began to experience death immediately. Why? Because his spiritual eyes, his physical eyesight began to take over. His spiritual eyesight was no longer working for him. Because when he walked in the spirit, he didn't see all this thing that was happening in the world. He didn't see his nakedness as long as he was walking in the spirit. He didn't see nor understand what it was like to be naked. But the moment he disobeyed God and did what the enemy persuaded him to do through his wife, his eyes became open, and immediately he knew that he was naked. He knew that he had sinned. He knew that he had disobeyed God. And what did he do immediately? He went to hide himself. He went to cover himself. Him and his wife Eve went to cover themselves. Why? Because they realized that they had made a mistake. They realized they had disobeyed God. And when God came to talk to them, because God loved his people, he loved his creation. So when he come to fellowship with them, hey, Adam, where are you? What was Adam? He was hiding. He has covered himself with fig leaves. And the first sacrifice that God made to shed blood was for Adam and Eve. He shed the blood of animals to have a skin to cover their nakedness. Friend, the blood that Jesus shed on Mount Calvary was for all of our sin. Every one of us have been set free by repentance and acknowledging Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior. We have a way out of the distress and the dilemma that we are facing. And that's through Jesus. That's through Jesus. Amen. The Bible tells us in the book of Romans chapter 5, verse number 8. But God showed his love for us in that while we were still sinners, he died for us. He died for us. Amen. See, we have a way out of this dark stage that we are in, this dark state that we're in. And that's through repentance. That's through acknowledging Jesus Christ. That's through turning away from our wicked lifestyles. Amen. Turn away from our sinful, wicked lifestyle. Amen. Why do we have to turn away? Because if God did not spare Sodom and Gomorrah for their wicked lifestyle, you think that you're better than they? They were human beings created in God's image just like you. You think that it's okay that you continue to live a life that is abomination before God? You think that is good? That people can look at you and that you can go and complain about what they are saying about you? You need to understand what God is saying about you. God said your lifestyle is abomination. God says your lifestyle has separated you from him. God said that your lifestyle has caused you to turn your back on him. Why? Because this is what you accepted. This is what you wanted. This is what you wanted to do. This is your own personal preference.
And it's become so open today that you see everyone coming out of closets.
Help them, Jesus.
First John chapter 2 and verse number 2. He is a propitiation for our sin. Who is he? Talking about Jesus. And not ours, not for ours only, but also for the sin of the whole world. For the sin of the whole world. 1 John chapter 1, verse number 10. If we say we have not sinned, we make him a liar. And his word is not in us. Amen. So God is showing us what we need to do, and he's giving us a way out. Amen. Look at 1 John 3:9. No one born of God make it a practice sin. We don't practice sin. We might make a mistake, but we don't practice it. Amen. It's not something that we look forward to doing. We are human beings. We're going to make mistakes. But that don't mean we continue in that mistake. The devil going to try to his best to keep you to thinking that you can't do no better. This is life, and this is the way it is, and that you have to accept it. The devil is a lie. You don't have to accept that. Amen. Amen. In Romans chapter 8, and let's look here now, because this is good. Let's look at verse number 1. There is therefore now no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after what? The flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus had made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and for sin condemned sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For they that are after the flesh do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. For to be carnally minded is death. To be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Because the carnal mind is enmity against God. Amen. And one verse said the carnal mind is hostile against God. It's hostile to God. Amen. In other words, it's not good. For it is not subject to the law of God, neither indeed can be. So then they that are in the flesh cannot please God. So that they that are in the flesh cannot please God. Amen. Look what it goes on to say. Verse number 9. Romans 8, verse 9. But ye are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit. If so be that the Spirit of God dwell in you. Now, if any man have not the Spirit of Christ in, if not have not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin. But the Spirit is life because of righteousness.
But if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwell in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal body by his spirit that dwelleth in you. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not of the flesh, not of the flesh to live after the flesh. For if ye live after the flesh, ye shall die. But if ye through the Spirit do mortify the deeds of the body, ye shall live. For as many as are led, there it is, Oka. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. God wants us to come to the reality of his indwelling presence. Amen. He wants us to come to the reality of his indwelling presence. When God showed me that darkness that was coming upon the face of the earth, and he said, warn my people. And I said, God, why are you telling me this? I'm not a pastor, because I wasn't a pastor. I said, why are you telling me this? I'm not a pastor. You need to talk to the pastors. They the one has got speaking to
30 years ago, yeah.
It ain't the one speaking to the people. The wage of sin is death even 30 years ago. The wage of sin is death 10 years ago. The wage of sin is death 5 years ago. The wage of sin is death even today.
That's
the word. So as we understand what God is saying to us, and as we turn our heart to what God is saying, then we're going to see the manifestation of God's grace extended toward us. But if we want to continue to ignore what God is saying to us and continue to demand our way, then we're going to see the wrath of God. Because God's wrath is against the sin and the rebellious hearts. Oh my God. But as you yield to the Holy Spirit, we are no longer in the bondage to the sin and to the lust of the flesh. Oh, hallelujah. Now, y'all understand what we're talking about today? Because you see, we have an obligation. We have an obligation. Because God said to preach it. Why, God, we just got to do what God said to do. But now I want you to look at something here now. I want you to look at something. Because you see, in Romans chapter 5, verse number 12. Now notice what it says here. Let's read verse number 1 first. Romans chapter 5, verse number 1, then we're going to pass it, going over. Therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Verse number 12. Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, so death passed over all men, for all have sinned. For until the law, sin was in the world. But sin is not imputed when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had no sin, after the similitude of Adam, transgressions, who is the figure of him that was to come. But not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one, many died. Much more grace of God and the gift of grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, had abounded unto many. Verse 16, and not as it was by one that sinned, so if the gift for the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more than which receiveth abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one Jesus Christ. Therefore, as by the offense of one judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience many was made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Moreover, the law entered that offense might abound, but where sin abound, grace did much more abound. That as sin had reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord. God is showing us something here. He's given us the tools that we, if we would take advantage of what God's saying to us and turn our hearts back to Him, we will see the hand of God so firm, so strong, that what the world is going through right now, they will begin to experience the deliverance, the peace, and the love of the Father one more time. God love you. God love America. God love the people He created throughout the earth. But God will not allow abomination to continue and not go unjudged. Judgment is coming to the sin which God called abomination. You know what that sin is? God is coming soon. And the abomination that bringing judgment on the world is being judged. Even those that pass those laws are about to be judged. God's not playing games. The wages of sin is death. But the gift of God is eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Return to God, and God will return unto you. Turn away from God, and God's wrath will come upon you. That's why we're seeing these disasters in these strategic areas. Because people are living a life of abomination. And the stench has come to the nostrils of God. And judgment is being poured out. People, hear the word of the Lord. Repent and turn from your wicked lifestyle to serve the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. For there is coming something upon the land, and it's coming very soon. You will not be able to go to the doctor for cleansing, for purifying. You need God, and you need Him now.
Yes, yes. Amen.
now. Why put it off? Why wait till the inevitable come? Take advantage of what God is saying to you right now. Yield to His Spirit. Yield to His leading. Yield to what God is saying to you. Because what God is saying to us right now is so important. Amen. Now I'm going to give you a couple more scriptures. Because I believe that we're in a time where God is trying to get our attention. And He's doing it in a very unique way. Amen. So that's in Psalms. How you doing, sir?
I'm well.
Good to see you.
How are you?
I'm awesome. I'm awesome. Glory to God. Psalms. Chapter 66. Psalm 66. Start verse number 18. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. Now see, that's powerful. If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. But verily God had heard me. He had attended to the voice of my prayer. Blessed be God, which had not turned away my prayer, nor His mercy from me. See, God wants you to call upon Him with a repentant heart. See what he said in verse number 18 again? If I regard iniquity in my heart, the Lord will not hear me. And so what is he saying? Because you turn away from that iniquity, look at verse number 20. Because you turn away from that iniquity, but verily God had heard me. Because you turn away from it, God hear you. He had attended to the voice of my prayer.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Amen. When did it happen? When I turned my heart away from iniquity. When I turned my heart away from sin. Now God, hear me. Because he said in Isaiah 59 verse number 2, he said that what now? Let me just read it again. Isaiah 59 verse 2. And it says, but your iniquity have made a separation between you and your God, that your sin have hidden his face from you, that he does not hear. But now we see right here, when we deal with the sin in our life, when we deal with the iniquity in our hearts and in our life, God said right here in his word, in verse number in Psalms 56, verse number 19, but verily God had heard me. Why did he hear me? Because I turned away from my iniquity. Because I repented. Because I began to acknowledge Jesus Christ. I began to turn my heart back from my own lifestyle to the life that God had called me to live. I choose God rather than sin. You know, that's what happened when people don't understand. When you choose sin over God, you are turning. You don't even realize, but you're turning away from God. And I know for a fact that God has given us an opportunity to turn our hearts back for Him, because I know that before I started preaching this message, I was struggling in some areas. But when I started preaching this message, my life began to turn. I mean, I began to see things in my life that I know God wasn't pleased with. And as I began to see those things, I began to deal with those areas of my heart. I began repenting. I began renouncing. I began to turn away from them. And folks, let me tell you something. When I did that, now I can sit here I can come here on Friday night, I can sit here and start praying, and now God will speak to me just like this now. I hear from heaven just like this now. Why? Because I turned my heart away from the things that were blocking his voice. What was blocking his voice? Sin.
But preacher, you ain't blocking no. Yes, I did.
I ain't got no lie to tell you. I can't tell you no lie. I made mistakes. I'm a human being. Ask my wife. I make mistakes. She'll tell you real fast. Amen. So we make mistakes. We're human beings. We make mistakes. But when I started preaching this message on sin separates us from God, then I began to search the scriptures and see what all it involved. Let me tell you something. It began to minister to my heart. It began to minister to my heart. And as it began to minister to my heart, I began to give an account for what I was reading. And as I gave an account for what I was reading, God began to deal with my heart, and God began to deliver me. God began to heal me. God began to set me free in these areas in my life. And when he did that, now I have peace. I have peace. And I'm telling you, the devil bombarded my mind in such a way the last few months. He bombarded my mind in such a way that I thought I was about to lose it. But I started saying, God, I don't understand. I don't want this. I don't need this. I want you, God. I don't want this. I don't want this. I want you. And when I start renouncing it, when I start repenting of it, when I start turning my heart away from that stuff, let me tell you something. God began to show himself strong. And if he did it for me, I know he can do it for you. I've experienced God's deliverance. I've experienced God's redirecting my thought pattern, my hand, my feet, my heart, my everything. And if God did it for me, God can do it for you. God is not a man that he should lie, nor the son of man that he should repent. Amen. I believe God can change anybody that really want to be changed. Glory to his name. Hallelujah. Glory to his name. So now, when I look at this, when I look at what God is saying here, it says it in Psalm 66, verse 18 and 19, if I had or if I cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. Then I'm reading from another translation, English Standard Version. If I had cherished iniquity in my heart, the Lord would not have listened. But truly, God has listened. He has attended to the voice of my prayer. Why? Because I turn away from that iniquity. I don't cherish iniquity in my heart. My heart has been turned away from it. Amen. That's why God, hear me. Amen. Then 1 John chapter 2, verse number 1 says, my little children, I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous. Amen. In other words, when you make a mistake, when you make a mistake and you do sin, you have a way out. You have an advocate with the Father, and that's Jesus Christ. Amen. What do you mean, an advocate? When you make a mistake, when you sin, you can go to the Father. You can go to the Lord Jesus Christ and say, Lord, I have erred. I have sinned. And you, because you know when you sin. There's not a person on this earth that don't know when they sin, because every man knows right from wrong. And they choose wrong because they enjoy the lifestyle of doing wrong. That's why Satan was cast down from heaven, because he was living wrong. he's doing wrong. Amen. He wanted to exalt himself. Consequently, he is able to save us to the uttermost. This is Hebrews chapter 7, verse 25. Consequently, he is able to save us to the uttermost. Those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for him.
Atonement.
Huh?
Atonement.
That's right. The atonement. That's right. See, we have a access to the kingdom of God through Jesus Christ. But when we allow sin a greater access than Christ, we are no longer following after Christ. We're following after sin. Because sin has become more real than Christ. And because sin has become more real to Christ, it causes people to walk away from God. And this is what God was saying in his word in Isaiah 59 verse 2. Amen. Your sin has separated you between me and your God. Amen. Your sin has separated us. So now what God is saying to us right now, what God is saying to us, because you see, when we see all these disasters that is hitting these places and burning up everything like we did in Hawaii and this flooding that came and washed out everything like it did in Brazil, amen. And then when we see the things that take place in other areas, other parts of the land, amen. Then we kind of do a little background check. What was going on in that area, in those areas? What was so negative? What was so evil that judgment would come in such a way? What were they practicing? What were they doing? What kind of lifestyle were they living? Amen. And so we see that when you really look down through and you do background check and you read up on those areas, you see what lifestyle they were living, and it was just like Sodom and Gomorrah. And that's why they experienced disaster and death the way they have, because they have lived a lifestyle what God called an abomination to him. He didn't spare Sodom and Gomorrah for that. And he's not going to spare the people today for it, because it is abomination. It's a stench to his nostrils. Amen. Hallelujah. And I want you to know that my hour is up. Amen. Actually, I'm 10 minutes over, but that's okay. I just wanted to share, because this message, you know, like I told you earlier, God, I tried my best, a month and a half ago, to get off of this message. God said no. God will not let me stop this message. And I said, God, but the people don't want to come to listen to it. And he said, don't stop it. Just because they don't hear it here, it's getting in the spirit. And once it gets into the spirit, then people will hear by the spirit. And once they begin to hear by the spirit, they will begin to acknowledge and turn away from the sin. And not only that, preachers will get it in the spirit. They'll start preaching it also. But the thing about it, I wanted to stop it. God said no. So that's why I'm still preaching it. Amen. God said no. And as you see what we have today, hey, what can I say? I'm going to obey God. I'd rather obey God than to do the thing that pleases man in a day. Father, I thank you for your word. I thank you, Father, that your word will not return void. Father, I release it in the atmosphere, that which you have spoken to my heart and that which you have asked me to proclaim. I release it into the atmosphere, that it will drop on the ears of those that have an ear to hear what the Spirit of God is saying. I release it into the atmosphere, into the radio waves, into the airwaves, Father, that whomsoever will hear will begin to apply to their lives and turn from their wicked ways. Father, I ask in the name of Jesus that we all will come to the heart of repentance, that the judgment will be turned away from our land, from our people. I ask, Father, in Jesus' name, that you touch every life and give us that opportunity to turn. I give you all the glory for it in advance. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, I want to thank you all for joining us today. Now, we're going to go ahead on. Those of you that are with us by the internet, it's time for us to take about an offering. Amen. You that are with us by the internet, we're going to take about an offering. You can go to my website, libraryministries.com. You can sow a seed through your Cash App. You can send it through the Postal Service. That's P.O. Box 417913. Sacramento, California, 95841, excuse me. That P.O. Box 417913, Sacramento, California, 95841. Amen. Also you can use your PayPal and plant your seed that way. Amen. Cash App, Venmo. There's several ways you can plant your seed. We thank God for you. Amen. And don't forget you guys, we're planning on going back to Pakistan very soon. It's gonna be in October. I'm looking at October the 24th, leaving out. That's what I'm looking at. We're gonna see how that's gonna pan out. Amen. And then we're going to have our first crusade on the 25th.
Where's the crusade?
It's in Lahore, Pakistan. Lahore. We're going to have over 100,000 people on the field. We'll be preaching to over 100,000 people. And God has already gave me a word for that people. Amen. And if the Lord will bless me with the funds, I'm also go to Karachi, the last place I went. I was trying to get both places on this one trip so that my next trip out of the country will be to a different place. Amen. But God is good. God is showing us that He is with us and that. And so I'm just sticking with what He showed me. I'm sticking with Him. Amen. So, Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray over those that are sowing their seed by the internet. By the way, I thank you, all you that support us by the internet with your seed. I thank God for you. Amen. When you do that, I try my best to respond to you with a prayer request or something. I like to respond back to you. And so I thank God for you, for your support over the internet, those that are with us. Amen. So Father, in the name of Jesus, I release that anointing right now over the seed. I thank you, Father, that as they plant this seed today, Father, this seed will go into this ground, which you have called rich, fertile ground. God, you said it. I believe it. And because I believe it, I release, Lord God, the angels to go to work on behalf of those right now that are sowing their seed. That the ministering angels right now will begin to come against that spirit of lack, insufficiency. And I release, Father, in the name of Jesus, bonus, raises, settlements. I call, Father, new appointments, new business appointments in the name of Jesus. new business appointments, new door opening in Jesus' name. Glory to God. I receive that myself, Father. God, I give you praise and I give you glory for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. That's a good word. I receive that. Amen. So go ahead on, sow your seed. Amen. Father, I bless your people. If you never made Jesus Christ Lord of your life, I'm going to give you an opportunity for that also. You never made Jesus Christ Lord of your life. You know that God right now is dealing with your heart. And you want things, you want your heart right with God. And say this prayer with me. Say, Jesus, I repent of my sin. Forgive me, Lord. Come into my heart. Create in me a right spirit. And renew in me a clean heart. Jesus, I believe that you are the Son of God. And that you died for my sin. Today, as I confess my sin, I believe that you are faithful and just to forgive me my sin and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness. As I confess my sins today, I know that my sins are forgiven. Thank you, Father, for saving me. Amen. You said that prayer, and I believe that your sins are forgiven. And I believe that you are saved. Amen. We love you. We thank God for you. You need special prayer right now. I pray for you right now. Come on, sir. Hallelujah. Amen. Father, in the name of Jesus, God, I thank you for my brother. Holy God, you're so awesome. You're so good. You're so mindful of your people. Oh, my Lord, I release your healing anointing right now in the name of Jesus. And Father, I speak and I release your anointing on the ribs in the name of Jesus. And I command them to amend properly, line up, and be healed in Jesus' name. Now, Father, I give you all the praise and all the glory for it. I bless my brother. I cancel every assignment against his health. In the name of Jesus, God, you know him. You watches over him, God. He's a sportsman, but that's the way you trained him. And now, Father, restore him. And I give you all the praise and all the glory in Jesus' name. There go the anointing right now. I'm releasing it right now. There it is. Receive it, receive it, receive it. In Jesus' name, thank you for it, Father. Hallelujah. Thank you for it. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Anyone else want prayer right now? Anyone online want prayer? Amen. Well, Father, we thank you for this morning service. And as we prepare to leave right now, Father, we ask you, Father, that you will touch every heart under the sound of my voice, whether they listen to it right now or listen to it later. I ask you, Father, that you will touch their hearts and allow this word, Father, to become a living reality in their lives, that they will not be comfortable living in sin. Sin separates us from you. And so, Father, I ask you that you would cause us to see ourselves walking with you and not apart from you. Walking with you in obedience. Walking with you in righteousness. I bless your people now in Jesus' name. Don't forget to join us tonight. We have a message for tonight that I believe is going to touch your heart in a very powerful way. God has given me a message. He gave me a message on Friday night while we were praying. And he commanded me to begin to do more teaching on divine health and healing. And he wants us to begin to meditate along the lines of the healing, because he said there's coming something upon our land that we're going to need this. And he said there's going to be a recall of the message that he put in our hearts concerning healing. So let's get our hearts in the right place so that we can experience what God is saying. Amen. And I believe there's going to be something. If we don't do this, we're going to experience something we're going to wish we had or did it. God bless you. We'll see you tonight. We'll talk to you more about it tonight. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Larry.